Morning to everybody. So I was lucky to start my PhD advisor career, I would say, with Caroline. It was very efficient, very pleasant, and we also worked after that. And I was lucky with my starting point, I'd say, because my first postdoc student, let's say, was Martin Gander when I was at École Polytechnique, who will speak this afternoon. So I was lucky, once again. Okay, so, well, the slides I will show you were made with Victorita Dolean and Pierre Jolivet. Pierre Jolivet sits at the back, right here, okay. And also, we wrote a book together, which was published by SIAM at the end of last year. And you can download the PDF file of the book from the webpage of the CEMRACS with the agreement of SIAM publisher. And also, from the same webpage, you can download the last version of my slides. OK. So Caroline gave you a very good abstract of what domain decomposition methods are. So I will simply go into more details. But basically, you have the main ideas. So, first of all, what I will present corresponds to various applications. It corresponds, for instance, to Maxwell equations for brain imaging, for instance, or for linear elasticity, for instance, when you want to simulate the behavior of a tire. So, the world of partial differential equations. Oops. Okay, and as everyone knows, after discretization, you get a linear system, which is usually large and difficult to solve, especially when you are in a 3D situations. And one important feature of domain decomposition method is that there is an interplay between linear algebra, that you saw yesterday, and partial differential equations. Because the matrix here is a matrix, and what you have to solve is a linear algebra problem in the end, of course. But not used to that. Okay, but the properties of the matrix A come from the PD it comes from. And there are some ideas which are easy to get, let's say, at the partial differential equation level, as you will see soon. And you wouldn't have the same idea if you look only at the problem from a linear algebra point of view. And on the other hand, there are things which seem more or less natural when you look at the problem from a linear algebra point of view, and when you look at it from a partial differential equation or functional analysis point of view, you wouldn't have had the idea. Okay, so first, and there is a need for parallel computing, and I think this is one of the reasons why you are so numerous young students here, which is good. It is the fact that since the year 2005, there is a stagnation of the frequency of CPU, of processor, if you want, at around 3 GHz. So this is the red curve here. So you see, from year 2005, this is a real plateau. And there is no hope in the near future for any improvement. The problem is a problem of heat dissipation, in fact. So the only way to improve performance of computers is to increase the number of cores per node or per processor, as you want. So, if you double, let's say, or you quadruple the number of cores, you have a machine which is twice or four times more powerful. But this is only true if you take advantage of your cores, and the only way to take advantage of that is to have a parallel code. So there is a huge impact of this technological fact on the software industry and also in the electronic industry in general. I will come back to that later. Okay, so there is a need, and there is also the opportunity that now we have parallel computers everywhere. So laptops are usually dual or quad cores. You can easily have a PC with 6 or 12 cores. And now, for instance, in our laboratory, we have an SGI machine with 300 cores, which is already something. At the university level, we have access easily, let's say, to a bigger machine. And if you apply to an agency or price, agency is a French agency which provides computing hours for science, and price is the same thing, but at the European level, then you can have access to supercomputers with 100,000 of cores. So this is for the academic part. And also CNRS provides some hours. And also there are more and more commercial offers. So people who build these supercomputers like Bull, HP, IBM, and so on, also enable you to buy computing hours to their supercomputers. So you can have computing hours on demand, in fact. And also now with cloud computing and data mining, big names in internet like Amazon, Google, Microsoft sell, in fact, as well, computing hours on their big clusters. So it is these machines are available now, and they work well. And now the big issue is to take profit of this hardware, I would say, by devising a good method and good softwares which are really parallel. Okay, and this fact has changed the place where to make effort in scientific computing. So the first thing, of course, is to compute right. What I mean is when you have a PDE to have a good numerical scheme, good discretization scheme, that you can prove that when you refine the mesh, it will converge to the solution. So this is numerical analysis. Now we have even more sophisticated things like a posteriori error estimates, which gives you bound on the error of your numerical solution, only knowing the numerical solution, not knowing the exact solution, of course, which is very important to automatize the whole process of scientific computing. And there will be also a talk by Yvon Madet on reduced basis method. So all these things are still, of course, absolutely necessary. And so now, these research are, of course, still very active. The second thing is to compute faster. And in the past, it was very easy, because every 3 years, the performance of the machine would double. It was true until 2005. So basically, if you had money and effort to invest, you would, before that, before 2005, you would invest all your efforts in the numerical analysis part of scientific computing and simply wait 3 years and buy a new machine and have something that runs twice as fast. So now things have changed because machines change very slowly, let's say, improve very slowly. So you would invest only every 5 years, basically, to buy a new machine. And now, to take advantage of these new parallel machines, you have to invest in algorithmic research. And this is something new. And there is also something important, which is to use less energy. So in the past, nobody cared about that. But now this is a big issue. So this is a big issue for these very large parallel computers, because they really need a lot of energy and electricity to work. And this is also true at the very small level, for instance, for your smartphone or your laptop. You want to have battery. This is a big problem now. For that, you need to have algorithms that, that use less energy. And in fact, in modern computers, most of the energy is lost in the data transfer. And so there is a big effort in what is called the communication avoiding algorithm. And there's been many advances in this direction by Jim Demel, Laura Grigori, and other co-authors. OK, so the architecture is important, but we have a very simple view to it. You don't have to enter into the details of the hardware to see what will be to to guess what will be a good algorithm and what will be a bad one. So our simplified view is the following. So we have an unlimited number of fast cores. We have to distribute data among the cores. But we have a limited amount of slow and energy-intensive communication. So when I say slow, you have to think this is really something which will stay for a very, very long time. Because I said that there is stagnation in the CPU, in the frequency of the CPU. But this stagnation is at 3 gigahertz, which means 3 billion operations per second, which is huge, really huge. Okay. Now, when you move data, you cannot move them faster than the speed of the light, which is something, 300,000 kilometers per second, which is a lot. But if you want to simply move at the speed of the light from one position to 3 meters or 40 meters, it will take you something like 10 to the power minus 8 seconds, which is during this time, even with the fastest network you can think of, you will have time to make 10 operations. Okay, so slow communication will always be there now. Okay, so what is good now is to have what is called a coarse-grained algorithm. So coarse-grained algorithm means you maximize local computations and you minimize communication in order to save both time and energy. Because, when I say that, I mean that even you will do redundant computation, because redundancy, as long as there are local computation, is not a big issue. So don't be afraid to compute too much, but you have to be very careful with your communication. And you have to try to avoid any sequential task in your code, because at some point it will kill you, especially when you go to large machines. Okay, so I will focus on linear solvers, mainly on domain decomposition method, but I first want to say a few words about the other solvers available. So you have direct solvers, so LU factorization or Gauss factorization. So you have many very good libraries that are available. So MUMS, which is developed in France by Jean-Yves L'Excellent, which works very well. And SuperLU in the US, Pastix in France as well, UMFPAC, Pardiso by Olaf Schenk in Switzerland. And Pardiso, in fact, is available also when you use the MKL from Intel, so matkernel library from Intel. So the direct solver that is used in this library is in fact Pardiso. So I will come back to this method. The very good things with this method is that they are very easy to use, they are very robust, and if they are sufficient for your problem, you don't need to try to do something else. Stay with your direct solver. On the other end of the spectrum, I would say you have a purely iterative method, like Ryloff methods that were presented to you by Kiswick yesterday morning. And the ancestors of this method are simpler methods, like fixed point iteration method. So these methods are very light, are very easy to parallelize. They only demand a small amount of memory. So all these things are good, except that they are not robust. And in order to have some robustness, you need a good preconditioner. Direct methods are very robust, but when you go to large 3D problems, they cannot solve the problem. So there is a need for what is called hybrid method, method which takes advantage of both worlds, as we say, of direct solver and iterative method. So you have a multi-grid method. When you start with a very fine grid, and you approximately solve at the fine level, and then you go to a coarser level, where you approximately solve, and you go and then again to a coarser level, and so on. And at some point, the coarse grid is so small that you can solve it efficiently with a direct solver, and then you transmit the information back to the fine grid. So in this sense, you use both direct and iterative method. And what I will present now is domain decomposition method, which are, as you will see, a natural compromise between direct and iterative method, because these methods are naturally parallel. This is a very good point of domain decomposition method. You don't have to modify an existing algorithm to make it parallel. It is naturally already parallel. And this is very important. Okay, so once again, a few words about direct solver. So one very important thing about direct solver is that the efficiency depends a lot on the dimension your problem lives in. What I mean by dimension, are you solving a problem, a PD, partial differential equation, in 1D, or in 2D on a surface, or in volume in 3D, or even worse, if you have phase also. Okay, and when you have 3D problems, when you have 1D problems, in fact, these methods are absolutely optimal, and they will solve your problem very easily. When you are in 2D, basically, they also have a good complexity number. And basically, you can solve 1 million unknown problems in 2D with a direct solver without difficulty. You will run fast. But now, if you consider the same 1 million problems, but now in 3D, so the graph is different. The number of unknowns is the same, but the graph is very different. Then 1 million takes a lot of time with a direct solver. It can be done, of course, but it takes a lot of time. And a lot of memory. Okay, so practically what people are up to now, when you have a 2D problem up to 1 million unknown, people use a direct solver and they don't try something else. In 3D, up to 100,000 unknowns, they would use as well direct solvers. And beyond that, you have to go to iterative method. Okay, so now, if you look at linear algebra from the end user point of view, I mean, you are writing a code, and at some point you have to solve a linear system. So basically, you have direct solvers, so as I said, which are very robust but difficult to parallelize, and which cost a lot of memory, but which are very easy to use. I mean, your code simply, you add one line, and this is it. You have the matrix, the right hand side, and it will provide you the solution. The pure iterative method, like Kryloff method, they are very easy to parallelize because it is easy to parallelize the matrix vector product. They use a minimum amount of memory, let's say, but they lack robustness. But they also have the advantage to, in principle, to be very easy to use. Once again, if you download a Kryloff library, you simply have to add one line of code. And this is it. Domain decomposition methods, the good thing is that they are naturally parallel, as you will see soon. They are flexible, they can handle I will explain that later. But we do not still have, but there are still only few black box routines. Things are improving, and this is what I'll try to show, but they are not as easy to use as this ones. But they enable to go to very large scale computing. So multi-read methods are very efficient, but may lack robustness, as it was said by Matthew Kefne yesterday afternoon. So for instance, when you consider Darcy type problem, let's say diffusion type problems, they work very well usually. But when you go to a system of equations like elasticity or Maxwell, they are not always good. And also, when you go to propagative wave problem, then you can say that they do not work. Okay, so now I will present the mother of all algorithms, I would say, or the father, if you want, the Schwarz algorithm. So Schwarz was a German mathematician from 2 centuries ago now. And his goal was not to make parallel computing, of course, but to study the well-posedness of the Poisson problem. And at his time, there was no Lax-Milgram theorem, no Sobolev space, and so on, not all the things you were taught at university. And the main tool was Fourier transform. So for simple geometries like rectangle or disk. And the question he wanted to answer was, is it possible to say something if the domain is a union of simple geometries? So consider, for instance, the union of a disk and a rectangle, and the global domain, as you see, has a non-trivial boundary. The domain, global domain is the union of omega 1 and omega 2. And so, so you consider this Poisson problem with a homogeneous directly boundary condition. And his algorithm is the following. So U1n will denote an approximation of the solution in the disk omega 1 at step n of the algorithm, and U2n the same in the rectangle. And you want to improve this approximation. So what you do is that you will define a boundary value problem for U1 n plus 1, using as much as possible what you know on the exact solution. So you know that U1 plus 1 must satisfy the Poisson equation. On this part of the boundary, it has to be zero. So this is the second line. And now, on this part of the boundary of omega 1, which is artificial, it is here only because you decided that your domain is the union of these two domains. Well, you will ensure the continuity of the global solution by giving this directly boundary condition where the right-hand side comes from the previous iteration in the neighboring subdomain. And you do something similar in domain 2. So this boundary here, I will call them interfaces between subdomains. Okay, so the original Schwarz method was sequential. You have a plus one here, so you would solve first in domain one and then in domain two, and iterate on that. And using this algorithm, Schwarz was able to prove the well-posedness of the Poisson problem in non-trivial geometries for his time. It is very easy to have a parallel version of this algorithm. Simply, you suppress the plus one, which is in red here, and now you have a parallel algorithm, because you can solve independently the Poisson problem in domain 1 and in domain 2. And the only sequential part in this algorithm is when you exchange data in order to update the right-hand side of the Dirichlet boundary condition on the interfaces. And the good thing with this algorithm, it is a coarse-grained algorithm. Why? Because the main task, which is to solve a boundary value problem in each subdomain, is really parallel. And the only sequential part is on communication part, is when you exchange data. But the data you exchange is a small volume because this corresponds only to interfaces unknowns, so surface of the domain, compared to computation, which involve all unknowns in one subdomain. So you exchange few data and simply you move them. So this is what we call a coarse-grained algorithm. The drawback is that it converges very, very slowly if you use it as it is written here. For two reasons. First, because we do not use Krylov acceleration, and we'll see later on how to use it. And second, because what you see is that if there is no overlap, the method will not converge, which means that if the overlap is small, the method will converge slowly. And usually we have small overlaps, let's say one layer of meshes or two layers of meshes. So written like this, it is a slow method. But you will see there are many ingredients to have a faster method. Okay, so I forgot to say, of course, that you are encouraged to ask questions at any time when you want and for any subject. And it was so yesterday. If you do not understand something, most probably your neighbor has the same problem in his mind. Okay, so we'll stay for a little bit at the continuous level. So this is a sketch of the historic convergence in a simple case where you have only the domain omega is simply the segment, the interval 0, L. And on this interval, you solve the Poisson equation, which is in fact very simple in this case. It is simply the second order derivative of your function, which is equal to f for x between 0 and L, and you have, let's say, a Dirichlet boundary condition at the end of the intervals. Okay, so this is your domain, and it is decomposed into two overlapping subdomains, omega 1 and omega 2. And the thing is that if you write the Schwarz algorithm, so I don't want to write everything, but just to give you an idea of how it works. So, for instance, in domain 1, at step n plus 1, you will start this PD problem for x between L1 and 0, and you will impose 0 value at 0, and in the interface, which is simply L1, you will ensure the continuity of the solution at convergence by writing this. Now, if you introduce the error in domain 1 at step n plus 1, okay, then it is easy to see that this error satisfies the Schwarz algorithm, but with zero right-hand side. You subtract these two equations, and you get that the error is an harmonic function in domain omega 1. And since the continuity of the solution, the solution is continuous, when you subtract on both sides, you get, once again, this equality. Which means that now U1n plus 1 is an affine function, because it is in the kernel of the second order derivative, which has to be 0 at 0, so this is a linear function. And this is what is drawn here. So at step 1 of the algorithm in domain 1, the error is a straight line, which has to take the value, the initial value of the error in domain 2. So this is a straight line. And then when you solve in domain 2, let's say you take the original sequential method by Schwarz, the error in domain 2 will also be a straight line, which is 0 at capital L, and has to take the value of the error at domain at the boundary of domain omega 2, which is L2. So, and you see what is important, which is crucial for the convergence of this algorithm, is that you take advantage of the decrease of harmonic functions when you go away from the boundary of the domain. And this gives you some convergence. Okay, and then you can go on. The error in domain 2 at step 1 is this one, and so on. And you see that the method will converge. And you also see the importance of the overlap in this picture, and also that the smaller the overlap, the slower the convergence. So you would say, let's take a very huge overlap, but then, okay, if I take one subdomain is a global domain, then I did nothing. Okay. So in practice, we do not play too much on trying to find the good size of the overlap. Usually for practical reasons, and what is done is simply to take an overlap of size one mesh size or two mesh size. So you must imagine now that you have, when you discretize all these things, okay, so you will introduce a mesh, and basically the overlap would be something like twice the mesh size. Okay, so this is a simple 1D case, but you see many things on it. Now, if you want to have an insight of what happens when you have in a 2D situation, so the computation which is written here corresponds to a simple situation where your domain omega is R2, so the whole plane, where you solve this equation with some parameter eta, which is positive. And the domain is decomposed into two subdomains, two half planes, in fact. And let's say, for sake of simplicity, the boundary of a domain omega 2 is x equal to 0. And you have an overlap between the subdomains of size delta. This is the geometry. Okay, and what you can do in order to understand what's going on is to do the same kind of analysis that I've shown before. So the error will be an harmonic function in each subdomain. And in order to go on, what you do is that you introduce the Fourier transform in the y direction. Okay, because the y direction, there is no limitation in all subdomains. And the dual of the Fourier transform in the y direction is denoted by k, the wave number. And so, as usual, when you have a second order derivative in the y direction, it will correspond to plus k square number. Okay, so the partial Fourier transform of the error in domain omega 1 satisfies this equation. And if you consider a given k, given wave number, this is simply an ordinary differential equation, an ODE. And so you know that in order to solve ODE, simply what you do is to try to find solution of the form exponential of lambda x, and you get an equation on lambda. So in this case, what it will give is simply that, so if I put exponential lambda x in this equation, the second order derivative with respect to x will give rise to lambda square, so I will get this equation for lambda that you can solve very easily. So lambda is plus or minus the square root of eta plus k squared, and that I denote by lambda plus or minus of k. Okay, so so we have two branches of solution, let's say in domain omega 1. So the error should be a combination of these two exponential terms. But now, you have to remember that in domain omega 1, x can go to minus infinity. And since lambda minus is negative, this term can go to plus infinity. You take the exponential, so it is not admissible for a bounded solution at infinity. So the only way to have something admissible is to cancel the term gamma minus n plus 1, which means that the error in domain 1 has this form and depends only on one parameter, which is found on k, and you can do something similar in domain omega 2, except that now this is the other branch which will be kept, the one which decreases when x goes to infinity. Okay. And, well, so the only thing we have not used yet in the algorithm are the interfaces conditions, Dirichlet interface condition. And then this is very simple. You make a little bit of algebra, very simple. And what you get is that you have this relation, which links what happens in one subdomain at step n plus 1 to what happened two steps before in the same domain via a coefficient that I denote rho squared. Because basically, since here you go from step n minus 1 to step n plus 1, let's say it corresponds to square the convergence rate. And what is important is that this, you have this formula for the convergence rate, which depends, that there should be no alpha, which depends on delta, the size of the overlap, and the wave number k. And this is simply this formula. And lambda is given here. Okay, so what you see once again is that if delta is zero, you have no convergence. This is obvious, but you recover it on the formula. And you see as well that as delta is larger, the better the convergence will be. And also what you see on this formula is that if eta is equal to zero, well, no, let's say the other way around. If eta is large or not too small, then you have a bound of this convergence rate, which is good, because well, we have a bound anyway on the convergence rate, which is that rho of k and delta is smaller than the exponential of the square root of eta times delta. Okay, so if this term is not too small, then this is okay. You have a good convergence rate. And it could happen, for instance, when you start from a heat equation, for instance, with an implicit scheme. Then, the heat equation, I write it here. And if you take an implicit scheme, and I did not time by, okay, C plus delta T. Okay, so let's say at each step you have an implicit scheme, which means that at every step you have to invert a matrix which corresponds to the following PDE. 1 over delta t minus delta. And if for some reason your time step is small, then 1 over delta corresponds to eta, and then this term can be small. And then it will work very well. But if you solve a real Poisson problem, like Schwarz wanted to look at, and then what we often have to look at, especially, for instance, when you do incompressible fluid dynamics, you always have a Poisson problem somewhere. Then eta is zero, which means that for k equal to zero, your convergence rate is one, which is bad. You have no convergence. And we will come back to that later. Okay. So here I drew a picture of the convergence rate rho as a function of the wave number k for two overlaps. So in the red curve, the overlap is small, let's say, and the blue curve, the overlap is larger. So what you see is that as k tends to infinity, the convergence rate tends exponentially fast to zero, which means that you have a very fast decay of the high frequency part of your error. So the only place where you could have problem is with the low frequency part, and then it depends on the size of the parameter eta. Okay. Well, okay, so all these things were written at the partial differential equation level, but, okay, we do not use the main decomposition method to make theory on partial differential equation. No, we use them to solve linear system, so linear algebra problem. And so now we will look at the, we will try to, we'll design, let's say, a method which looks like the Schwarz algorithm, but starting only from algebraic idea. Okay, so you have some domain omega, which is here, after some discretization by finite element, finite difference, finite volume, you get a linear system to solve, where A is your rigidity matrix. Stiffness matrix, sorry. Okay, so so you have n unknowns, n degrees of freedom, and the first thing you would do is, let's say, to decompose your domain into two overlapping subdomains, and to look at the degrees of freedom which corresponds to domain omega 1, and to not to denote this set n 1, and do something similar with n 2. And here, in colored, you have the overlap between the subdomains, and you have redundant degrees of freedom, which belongs to both domain 1 and both domain 2. So very important notation, which is the restriction operator from the global vector of degrees of freedom to only degrees of freedom which belong to domain I. So this is operator R I. So in a matrix form, it corresponds to a rectangular matrix. And simply, it is a way to select the unknowns which belong to domain, to subset N1. So let's say you have a big vector, U1 and so on, UN. So matrix R1, which is a restriction matrix, is a Boolean matrix, where you have either one entry or zero, depending on whether you, in this case, for instance, U1 belongs to domain omega 1, U3 belongs to domain omega 1, but degrees of freedom 2 does not belong to domain omega 1, and so on. So this is a matrix, Boolean matrix. And its transpose corresponds to the extension by zero of local degrees of freedom of domain I to global vector of degrees of freedom. Okay, so you have an approximate solution that you denote by um, and you want to improve it in a, let's say, Schwarz spirit. So the first thing you do in an iterative method is to compute the residual. So f minus ua a applied to um, which is the only way to have some access to the error in your algorithm, because you do not know u, you want to compute it. So the only way to know if you are far or close to the solution is to compute the residual. And then what you would do is to restrict the residual to domain 1 and to solve a linear system with matrix A1, which is written here. So it is R1A R1 transpose. It corresponds simply A1 in simply the matrix you get from the global matrix by taking only the rows and columns which correspond to degrees of freedom of domain omega 1. It's an extracted matrix which corresponds more or less to a Dirichlet problem, let's say, in domain omega 1. So you solve the problem like this, and you can, this way, update your approximation of the solution in domain 1. So U1M is a restriction of to domain 1 of the global approximate solution UM. And now, in the overlap, you have two updated values, U1M and U2M. So you have to put them together. And for this, another very important concept, let's say, is the partition of unity. So it corresponds to, let's say, diagonal matrices, D1 and D2, one for each subdomain. And this is a way to glue together information coming from different subdomains. So for instance, in this case, what you would do is, in the overlap, to take the diagonal entry of D1 equals to 1/2. For the interior unknowns inside domain omega 1, you take 1. And you do something similar for D2. And then you have, at the algebraic level, discrete level, partition of unity. So identity, I here is the identity, identity for r to the power the number of degrees of freedom in the global problem. So it looks like a partition of unity in functional analysis, except that we do not demand any continuity or things like that in the function. Okay, and using this partition of unity, you can glue together your approximate updates to build a new update, which now is defined uniquely for all degrees of freedom. And this algorithm, in fact, is what is called the RAS algorithm for restricted additive Schwarz. And you can see it, let's say, like a weighted overlapping block Jacobi method. So so I will speak about Jacobi method because, in fact, this is a building block in Schwarz method. So now we establish a connection, let's say, between Jacobi method and this kind of method. Well, when you have a matrix A, What you can do is to introduce this diagonal that you denote by D, and then you can write an iterative method, which is a Jacobi method, which is written like this. Okay, you compute the residual. You make an approximate solve, if you want, of the residual by taking only the inverse of the diagonal. And you update this way your approximate solution. OK, so this is Jacobi method. Now you have the block Jacobi method, which consists, instead of simply taking the diagonal, for instance, if you have only a 2x2 matrix, is to take, for matrix D, the block diagonal matrix, which is made of A1 and A2. And the algorithm is the same, so this is a block Jacobi matrix that you must have learned in your studies, which is in fact a parallel algorithm because you can solve for A1 and A2 in parallel. Now, in fact, what we are doing, which is in fact to introduce not such a decomposition of the matrix, but a kind of overlapping decomposition of the matrix, where you would have two blocks, A1 and A2, which overlap. And then you build a preconditioner, keeping the same ideas, and you will end up with this algorithm. OK. So now, in fact, we have two algorithms. We have the Schwarz algorithm that you can discretize easily. You discretize the PD, the boundary condition, and so on. And this algorithm iterates on a pair of local functions, U1m and U2m. On the other hand, we have the RAS algorithm, which iterates on the global function um. And so these algorithms cannot be identical. They cannot be the same, because they do not manipulate the same kind of quantities. But there is a strong connection, and it is a result by F. Statue and Martin in 2002, which says that, in fact, there is some equivalence in the following meaning. If you call, well, first, you define an iterative RAS algorithm, which corresponds to computing the residual, and apply this preconditioner, in fact, approximate solver, in fact, and then update U in this long way. And U1n and U2n are what you get when you discretize the original Schwarz method. And what you have, in fact, is that the RAS iterates are exactly equal to a weighted a combination, weighted sum, of the Schwarz iterates. So the RAS method is, in fact, the good way to implement the Schwarz method because, well, you see that this, well, you have a formula which is easy to use and so on. So the only thing you need to have is restriction and partition of unity and local symmetries. But if you start from the Schwarz method, you have to introduce the discretization of the Dirichlet boundary condition to move explicitly the right-hand side and so on. But in fact, this, with this equivalence, you see there is no need, in fact. So this is very important. The other surprising thing is that the iterates of the Schwarz algorithm do not depend on any partition of unity. Nowhere in the Schwarz algorithm I spoke about partition of unity. But in the RAS algorithm, it seems to play an important role. But in fact, if you look only at the convergence rate, due to this equality, it proves that, in fact, it has no importance. The only importance of the partition of unity in this case is the way you glue together your approximate solution. So it could be smoother in some situations and so on, but this is the only thing. It has no influence on the convergence rate. OK, so as I say, in practice, we do not use this fixed point method, which is too slow. But in fact, we use the RAS preconditioner in Kryloff method, like a conjugate gradient, or in this case, a GM-REST method. And then it works reasonably well for many problems, let's say. Okay, so now there is something to understand, especially to understand the literature in domain decomposition method. So we have this algorithm, the RAS algorithm, which somehow is the most natural one, I would say, but which is not symmetric. Even if you start from a symmetric matrix A, your submatrices A1 and A2 will be symmetric. Here I've written the algorithm for capital N subdomains. Okay. But due to the partition of unity here that you apply on the left but not on the right, this preconditioner is not symmetric. So in practice, it's not a big problem because you will take GM-REST or a BiCG-STAB type Kryloff method, which are made for non-symmetric problems, and it will work. But for the theory, it is a big problem because usually we have very good tools for symmetric problems, especially symmetric positive definite problems. But when you have non-symmetric problems, it's much harder. So what people do is that they take symmetric variants of the algorithm in order to be able to build a theory. And for instance, this is the RDT coarse method, which is written here, which simply consists in dropping the partition of unity here, so that now you have a symmetric preconditioner. And for this, symmetric preconditioner, you have many sharp estimates of the efficiency of your preconditioner. Okay, well, later on I will introduce another variant, but okay. So in practice, what people do is that they use the RAS algorithm because it is more efficient, and they do the theory for the Dedich-Schwarz method. And if someone can solve this problem, I would say he will get famous, at least in some community. Okay. So now, a few numerics.
Sorry,
yes.
I'm a bit lost. So yeah. I would like to, just to make sure that I understand something in between the RAS algorithm and the
Dedich-Schwarz method. Right.
So just before you told me that basically, methods are identical.
Okay, understood. Okay. The Dedich-Schwarz method is not the discretization of the Schwarz algorithm. You're right, that's the question, yes.
So this is okay, so the oui. Schwarz algorithm is exactly the RAS algorithm,
yes.
So that's the RAS method, except that the RAS method is a way of representing the solution somehow.
Yes, sure, yeah.
Okay, so that's, and it depends on the DI, while the Dedich-Schwarz method does not depend on the DI.
No.
Convergence rate of the RAS algorithm does not depend on the DI.
Yes, no.
So instead, for the ASM, it should depend on the DI. Right?
But in fact, you write no DI in here.
Yeah.
So it depends on the way you prove it. But basically, there is no partition of unity, both in the original problem and in the preconditioner. Yes, because in the overlap, you do too much work, I would say, with the Dedich-Schwarz method, because you had twice a correction, whereas you should weight them. Okay, so maybe it's time to ask questions, because you said maybe some other people are lost, I don't know. Okay, so if I sum up, maybe it's useful. Okay, in fact, so we have three algorithms, I would say. We have the original Schwarz method. Okay. That you can discretize, which is corresponds to what I sketched here. You have the RAS algorithm, which is written, the RAS preconditioner is written here, and the RAS iterative method, let's say, is written here. And in fact, you have an equivalence, let's say, between the discretization of the original Schwarz method and the Dedich-Schwarz method. on the restricted additive Schwarz method RAS. And you have a third algorithm, which is the additive Schwarz method, which is a symmetric variant of RAS. Okay. But by the way, the paper by Martin and F-Statue clarified many things that were, as you say, not very clear. Okay, so just a few results to show you the efficiency of using a Krylov method. So just a toy problem, so we have a square divided either into four squares, so I mean you divide by yourself, or what you get, and then you, once you have a partition, you can have, add some overlap by adding for each subdomain layers. One layer with overlap equal one, two layers if you want larger overlap. Well, it is easy to do if you have a square divided into squares, but when you have something complex in general, you will be lost to do it by hand. You cannot do it by hand. So you will use an automatic graph partitioner like Métis, which was written in the US, or Scotch, which is written in Bordeaux, by François Pellegrini. And then this automatic mesh partitioner can be applied to any situation. And what they try to do is to balance the work between subdomains. So to have as possible the same number of degrees of freedom in each subdomain. And they try to minimize communication between subdomains. But in simple cases like this, it's not very impressive. But when you have complex situations, usually these methods perform very well and are basically fast. These are graph partitioners, okay. And then once again, you can have overlap by extending each partition with one layer of neighbors or two layers of neighbors for each subdomain. On the left, so here, you have a convergence curve. So here you have the log of the error, and here you have the iteration count. Starting from, you cannot see here, and I have difficulties as well, so this is 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, so, well, you end up at 60 iterations here. Okay, and you have several curves depending on the size of the overlap. So if the overlap is small, you have the blue curve. If you increase the overlap, you have the red curve. If you increase again the overlap, you have the green curve. So this is for the purely iterative method. So the RAS algorithm has a fixed point method. Now what you can do, which is much more efficient, is to use the RAS method as a preconditioner in a Krylov type method. Okay? And then you have the curves on the right. And you see, first of all, that the iteration counts are much better. So the maximum iteration count is something like 16 compared to 60. Okay? So it runs much faster. And also, there is still a dependency on the size of the overlap, but it is almost nothing. I mean, by increasing the overlap, you gain four iterations, which is not a lot. Okay, so this is a toy problem, but this is instructive as well. And also what you see, which is a little bit funny. Well, okay. Okay. So nowadays, you always have to use Krylov acceleration. Never do fixed point method, except that the only interest in fixed point method is that it is easier to think about the method as a fixed point method than as a preconditioner. So usually what people do is that they sketch the algorithm, a new algorithm, let's say, like an iterative method. And from this, they extract, if you want, the fact that this is a preconditioner, and they use it as a preconditioner in Krylov method.
Excuse me. Mm. How does this depend on the partition?
When you have overlap, not too much. For overlapping methods, it's relatively robust. Okay, so these are small examples with small number of domains, two domains in the theory, four domains in the test case, but of course we want to go to many subdomains. And then you have some vocabulary to know, which is very important. You have two notions of scalability. The first one is called strong scalability. it is the following situation. You have a fixed size problem, and you want to go faster by using more cores or more computers, let's say. Okay, so this is strong scalability. And this is usually, you cannot go that far, because for instance, you have 1 million degrees of freedom in your problem. Maybe if I give you 4 cores, you will be 4 times faster than with one. But with 1 million cores, you wouldn't be 1 million times faster. It would be strange. Okay? So there is some limit in this thing, although this is some people want to have, especially engineers. The other notion is weak scalability. So this is something different. The size of the problem is fixed per subdomain. So as you increase your computer resources, you increase the number of degrees of freedom. So it corresponds to situations where you are not happy with the number of degrees of freedom you have. For instance, people, if you do oceanography, basically you would like to model the whole Earth with all the oceans, seas, and so on. And up to now, you have to bound the oceans, which doesn't make sense. And so you get into trouble, and so on. So usually, these people would like to be able to solve the very, very big problem. And now they can have access to very large machines. So what they would like to have is what is called weak scalability, which means that as you increase the size of your problem, you increase the computational resources, and the whole clock time is fixed. Okay. The thing is that with the method I've shown you, which we call one-level method, you do not achieve scalability. So in this test case, this is a very simple test case. So what is done is that we have a domain which is simply a rectangle. Right, let's see. No. Well, you start with a rectangle, you say, with two subdomains. So you might imagine that this is domain omega 1, domain omega 2, and inside each subdomain you have a fixed number of grid points. And then you enlarge your domain by adding more degrees of freedom. So this is a weak scalability experiment, and so on. So starting from 8 subdomains to 64 subdomains. Okay, and what is shown here is the number of iterations of the Aditi-Schwarz method used as a preconditioner in a Kryloff method. And you see that the iterates figures increase from 18 to 128. And what is important is that, in fact, the number of iterations depends on the number of subdomains in one direction. So in this case, we have a 1D decomposition. So when you double the number of subdomains, you basically double the number of iterations. And okay, so the method is not scalable as it is. And okay, so another look at the same situation. So on the left, you have the convergence curve, which corresponds to the same test case than here, with 64 subdomains. So here you have the log of the error, and here you have the iteration counts. And you see here a beautiful plateau, very bad, very long. And then at some point, a sharp decrease of the error. Okay. So this is for the one-level method, but if you improve the method by adding a second level, and this is what I will explain now, you have a much better convergence curve. Okay. Now this is another illustration of the same phenomena. So here you have, by the way, it is taken from the PhD manuscript of Caroline. So you have decomposition into squares, so 2 by 2 squares, 4 by 4, 8 by 8. And you have the convergence curve. So once again, the log of the error as a function of the iteration counts. And for the one-level method, you see that when this is this curve for 2 by 2 subdomains, 4 by 4 is here, 8 by 8 is here. And you see that you have a plateau which is longer and longer as you increase the number of subdomains. And in fact, what is important isn't the number of subdomains, but the number of subdomains in one direction. And now, when you add a second level, this is the curve with M2, convergence curves are much better. Okay, so you have several ways to look at this problem. They say you have a theoretical way, so I will not enter into detail because I don't want to make proofs here. Okay, but for the Aditi-Schwarz method, what you can prove is that, in fact, the largest eigenvalue of the precondition system is bounded by the number of colors you need to color your subdomains. Okay. What I mean to color is that two neighboring subdomains must have different colors, like a map in like a map. Okay. So usually this number of colors is a fixed number, even though you increase the number of subdomains. So which means that the largest eigenvalue of the precondition system is bounded by something which is more or less a constant, which is not too big. So this is good. Because in Krylov method, the convergence count depends on the spectrum of the precondition system. So on a classical estimate for the convergence rate of a precondition Krylov method is to look at the condition number of the precondition system, which is the largest eigenvalue over the smallest ones. So here, obviously, the maximum eigenvalue is good, under control. And which is good as well, it is, well, this result is valid as soon as A is a symmetric positive definite matrix. And this is the only assumption you need. So this is a very general result that you can use in many, many situations. It does not depend on where the matrix comes from. Okay, so the problem, obviously, will come from the small eigenvalues. So in fact, sagdation corresponds to a few very low eigenvalues in the spectrum of the precondition problem. And you can see that on this picture. In the classical Schwarz method, if you want, subdomain I at each iteration exchanges data information only with its neighboring subdomains. But if you consider a Poisson problem, let's say the low frequency part of the solution, will depend on the value of f everywhere. This is a property in functional analysis of the Poisson problem. So which means that the solution on the most left subdomain depends on the value of the right-hand side in everywhere and also in the rightmost subdomain. And with one-level method, since you move information only from one subdomain to its neighbor, you need at least a number of iterations equal to the number of subdomains to have some convergence. Simply to have this subdomain knows something about the right-hand side in the subdomain which is here. Okay, so a classical remedy for this kind of situation corresponds to the introduction in coarse problem that will couple all subdomains, so I will come back to that. So this is the domain decomposition method vocabulary, if you want. But this problem of bad eigenvalues for a given preconditioner is something classical in linear algebra. And then, basically, an equivalent solution is called a deflation technique. So you have a paper by Youssef Saad and Chris Wick and co-authors on this paper, on this subject. And this is also very closely related to multi-grid techniques, but with some difference. Okay, so the first to propose a solution to this problem was Nikolaides in a paper in 1987. So he proposed the following thing. Okay, so here you have the Aditi-Schwarz method preconditioner. So you keep it in your preconditioner, but you will improve your preconditioner by adding a second level, the two here, by adding simply this term. So what is this term? So, you take a rectangular matrix, Z, let's say with as many columns as subdomains, for instance. And you consider, in fact, this rectangular matrix Z, which is a skin and a tall, as in fact a basis for a coarse vector space that we will call VH. So VH is the span of the columns of Z. And for some beauty, let's say it's a notation, you introduce R0, which is Z transpose. Okay, and what you do is that you consider this matrix. So this matrix is R0 A R0 naught, which is simply Z transpose AZ. AZ. So this matrix is square. It is a small matrix. Its size is, in fact, simply the number of columns in Z. So typically, if you have, I don't know, 1,000 subdomains, which is already something, this matrix is a small matrix, 1,000 by 1,000, and which is sparse as well, if Z has some sparsity as well. Okay, so what you do is that you add to your original one-level method this correction term, and this is called the second level because when you invert this small matrix, you will in fact couple all subdomains at once at each iteration. And then it provides your global, let's say, mechanism to your basic one-level method. So now you still have to choose the good matrix, rectangular matrix Z. And Nikolaides made the following diagnosis, if you want, is that the problems come from the kernel of the Poisson equation, which is a constant function 1. And so you have to build a coarse space which contains this kernel. So in order to do that, what you do is that you take, if you have a P1 finite element, you can identify the constant function 1 to degrees of freedom equal to 1 everywhere. So you take a vector of all 1s of the size your global problem, and for each subdomain I, you restrict this constant vector to subdomain I, you multiply by the partition of unity, and you extend by zero. So basically, and you do that for all subdomains, so your matrix Z will look something like that. So it has as many columns as subdomains. And let's say for domain, one, it will be one for the interim points. For the points is overlap, you will have the partition of unity, and then zero. It corresponds to omega one. And then since you have overlap, the degrees of freedom of omega two overlap with the ones, with the other ones, and you will get something like that. And so on. And of course, if you take the sum of these columns, you get the vector of all ones because you've used the partition of unity in defining the coarse space. And this is very important. Okay, and it works. So it works from two points of view. For a theoretical point of view, so Nicolas had some proofs that it works for the Poisson problem. And the proof was later on refined and extended to more complex situations by many people, but among them important works by Vildoun and Dria. So they proved the following theorem, which is very general. So the condition number of the precondition system with the two-level matrix is bounded by a constant which does not depend on the number of subdomains, which is very important. It depends only on the shape of the boundaries of the subdomains, times 1 plus h over delta, where h is typically the diameter of a subdomain, and delta is the width of the overlap. So we see something like that. So you have your subdomains which are like this. The result is true for general decomposition, let's say. So H is this. And now, well. Okay. Now, if I consider this domain I, let's say, so H is the diameter of the subdomain. And now if you consider the overlapping zone, which is the part of domain omega I, which belongs also to another subdomain. So it gives you this picture, which has a minimal width, let's say, which is somewhere here, that you call delta. So this is the width of the overlap. OK, so they proved this result, and which means that the, which is very good because, so once again, C does not depend on the number of subdomains. And the convergence rate you have here is the same you would have if you had only two subdomains. So it means that weak scalability is rich with this result. And in practice, it works very well. So here, you have the same test case than before, so decomposition into vertical slabs from 8 to 64 subdomains. If you take the one-level method, you have an increase, linear increase in the iteration counts. If you use the two-level Schwarz method by Nikolai Dess, the iteration counts are almost stable, 27, let's say. And the extra cost is very small. The extra cost is simply at each iteration to invert sparse metrics of size the number of subdomains. So for instance, in this case, a metrics of size 64 by 64. OK. So it is important to note that you have other correction formula. In fact, you have two ingredients in this second level method. You have the coarse space, Z. So in Nikolai Dess' case, it is what I sketched here. And you have the way you modify your original one-level method to take advantage of your coarse space. And in fact, you have a whole algebra of these things, which is very well explained in a paper by Chris Wick and Naben and the co-authors. And you have several formulas, which all involve this kind of thing. So E is a small matrix, let's say Z transpose AZ. Q corresponds to this formula. And you have a projector P, which has this formula. And all these methods can be written in terms of P, Q, E, and so on, especially P and Q. And for instance, Nikolai Dess is simply that you take your original one-level method, M minus one, which in this case is the RDT Schwarz method, one-level one, and you add a correction. And now you have a more sophisticated one, which works better and is easier to analyze, in fact, which was devised by Mandel, which is called the balanced Neumann-Neumann, but you can forget the Neumann-Neumann, let's say this is the correction formula. So now your one-level method is here. And what you do is before applying it, you use projection P, and when you are finished, let's say you use pre-transpose, and you apply your correction only here. And the advantage is to decorrelate what you do when you work in the coarse space from what you do in the complementary, if you want, of the coarse space. And you have, let's say, variance in between these two extremes, if you want. And also, another important point with deflated or balanced Neumann-Neumann method is that they have the very good following property, is that if I call Rn the residual at self n of any Kryloff method, then if when you start the algorithm, the residual is orthogonal to the core space, then it will be true at every iteration, even much before convergence. So this is important because sometimes you want to ensure as well, I don't know, for instance, if you have density, for instance, you want to ensure the conservation of mass, which more or less will correspond to saying that the sum of the densities will be equal to one or something like that. But simply you can do it by adding that in your core space, use the kind of correction formula, balanced or deflated, and you run a Kryloff method, and at every iteration, even though you have not reached convergence, mass will be conserved. Okay, well, it's very good to stop now, and because I will skip to another subject after the pause. And please feel free to ask questions. And,
Thank you.
Yeah.
Do you have questions? No? So I have one question. Can you say a little bit more on the dependency of the methods with the PDE? I mean, if you have heterogeneous coefficients.
Okay, this is after the break. Okay, what I've shown here works very well for constant coefficient operators or slowly variable coefficients, if you want. But when you have heterogeneities, you have to have more involved coarse space correction. But now this is under control, and I hope I will have time to explain that after the break.
And when you have a system like Stokes, or is there something on that?
Stokes, in practice, we have something that works. Theory is not complete, but yes, now we have things. That. But I wanted to introduce ideas with a model equation,
yes,
and then go on after the break to more recent and sophisticated things.
Okay, so thank you, and we have now the coffee break. And
Laura wants to add something. So before going on, there was some when I did before the break, there were some calculations that were missing and things like that. So if you want to have more details, you can look at the PTF file of the book. This is one thing. And second, I realized thanks to some questions that I forgot to say something very important, which is you must have that as a reflex if you want when you look at the at parallelism, in fact, in general. It is the fact that as soon as you have a sum, you have parallelism. Because when you evaluate, when you apply this to some vector, you have a sum, which means that you can evaluate each term separately, concurrently. And this is only when you sum them that you have some sequential part. And for instance, in this case, usually you apply a preconditioner to a residual, which is a global vector. In fact, you restrict it to your subdomain, but in practice, you do not do this operation. In practice, in your code, what is done is that you store only the local value of the residual. So this notation, which is very powerful, in fact, to have a compact form of the algorithm, does not correspond to the way it is coded. Okay? So in practice, what is done is that you have a local version of the residual. You solve a local subproblem, so you can do this in parallel. You apply locally a partition of unity. And then when you extend by zero a new sum, in fact, it corresponds to send only data that are in the overlap, and you send this data to the neighbors. So this is what is called point-to-point communication in MPI. And this can do all together. I mean, all subdomains can exchange with their neighbors all together. And in fact, what you sum, it corresponds only to the sum on the overlaps. Okay, so in fact, you do not extend by zero. Simply, you update your local value of the preconditioner to which you apply to the residual. Okay. I will come back to these things later. Okay, so now I will speak about optimized restricted Eddie Schwartz, which corresponds to the Lyons algorithm, which is, let's say, an important variant of the classical Schwartz method, and which is a method of choice when you have to solve a propagative wave problem in the frequency domain, like Helmholtz or Maxwell equations. Okay, so. First of all, Pierre Lyons' algorithm is written here. So Pierre Lyons wrote three papers in domain decomposition method corresponding to the first three international DDM conferences. And the first one was in Paris, I think. Yes. Okay. And in the third conference, so Pierre Lyons introduced this algorithm. So for solving, once again, let's say, elliptic problem. So the main difference is here on the interfaces. Instead of using directly boundary condition on the interface, you use Robin boundary condition. So alpha is some positive parameter that you choose. You are free to choose as you want. You take it positive in order to have a well-posed problem. And now, on the interface between the subdomains, to ensure the continuity of the solution, instead of writing directly interface condition, you enforce the continuity of the Robin operator, let's say, so normal derivative plus alpha applied to your unknown. So concerning notation, so N1 is the normal outward normal to domain omega 1. And N2 is the outward normal to domain omega 2. Okay, this is like this. Okay, and the good thing with this algorithm is that when there is no overlap, you have a converging method, which is a great improvement compared to the original first method. The original first method with direct interface condition, when you have no overlap, you have no convergence. Here, in this case, Pierre Lyon's proved by energy estimate method the convergence of the algorithm. But of course, the method can be used as well when you have overlapping some domains. There is no theoretical restriction, let's say, for that. And then what it will do is that you will have a convergence rate which will depend much less on the overlap between the subdomains. Okay, so in practice, when you have this kind of Poisson problem, and when you add a second level method to the original Schwarz method with direct interface condition, you already have good convergence rates, which means that for a pure Poisson problem, you have little incentive to use this variant. But when you go to more sophisticated, more general problem, like a convection diffusion equation, like Caroline considered in her PhD thesis, or for wave propagation phenomena, like Helmholtz equation, then directly boundary condition can really hamper the convergence, and you can much improve the convergence by using Pierre Lulion's idea. And concerning the Helmholtz equation, so this algorithm was extended to Helmholtz equation by Bruno Després in his PhD thesis, and also to the Maxwell equation. And it was a real breakthrough for this kind of problem, because before that, for propagative wave phenomena, in the frequency domain, when you look at the PD, it is a symmetric operator, but it is not positive any longer. It is an indefinite problem. and then, before this algorithm, there was no iterative method with a proven convergence for this kind of propagative wave phenomena. And this is via the domain decomposition method that, for the first time, there was a provable iterative solver for this kind of problem. And this method is also known in the literature under the name of FETI 2LM. Okay, so in order to see, let's say, the importance of this parameter alpha and the change in the interface condition, what you can do is to perform a Fourier analysis as it was made for the Dirichlet problem. Okay, and I skip all details, but what you get is the convergence rate, which depends, as before, on the wave number k, which depends on the size of the overlap delta, and also on the parameter alpha. And this parameter is a free parameter. The only thing that it has to be positive, when you have convergence, the converged solution does not depend on alpha. So alpha is simply something that you have at your disposal, let's say, to improve the convergence rate. Okay, and you have this formula for the convergence rate. So what is important here is that, first of all, even if delta is equal to zero, I mean you have no overlap, you have convergence. Because here you have a positive term minus alpha, which is positive, over the sum term plus alpha. So this is smaller than one. So for any k, this rational fraction is smaller than one, you have convergence. But of course, if you have an overlap, I mean delta is positive, you also still have benefit of the overlap. And in fact, the exponential term here is exactly the convergence rate we had for the Dirichlet-Schwarz method, with the original Schwarz method. And since the new term here, the rational fraction, is smaller than one, it means that in this case, you always gain by using this algorithm compared to the classical Schwarz method. Okay. So now, now we have to choose alpha in order to have the best convergence possible. For any positive alpha, we have convergence, but maybe by choosing carefully alpha, we can have better convergence rate. And there is a big difference between the situation where you have overlapping subdomains, where you have the exponential term here, and the non-overlapping case, where delta is equal to zero, and you are only left with the rational fraction. So first, I start with the overlapping subdomains. So you have an implement issue, is that if you consider the algorithm, it is difficult to discretize. For instance, in domain, in one domain, let's say omega one, let's say you have to solve the Poisson problem. So in domain omega one, you have on this part of the boundary, which is also part of the global domain, you have the original Dirichlet boundary condition. So this is this part of the boundary. And now on the interface, you have the Robin boundary condition. Okay, suppose you have a finite element discretization. It is easy to write a variational formulation of this problem. To make it simple, I forget about the Dirichlet boundary condition here, on the, this part of the boundary. And what you do simply is that you take a test function V1, which lives in from function from omega 1 with value in R. You integrate by part, and you get something like the integral over domain omega 1 of grad u s plus u n plus 1 grad v1 minus the integral on the interface of the normal derivative times v1 is equal to the right hand side coming from f. So you get this. And then in order to enforce the Robin boundary condition, what you do classically is that you substitute the normal derivative by alpha plus, enfin, alpha times u1 n plus 1, and this part will go to the right-hand side. So what you get in the end is something like that, the integral over omega 1 of grad u1 n plus 1 grad v1 plus alpha integral on the interface of u1 n plus 1 times v1 is equal to the integral of f v1 plus integral on the interface of v1 times the right-hand side of the Dirichlet, of the Robin, sorry, boundary condition. Okay, so we get something like this. Get this variational formulation. So up to here, it is very easy. And in fact, if you look at bilinear form, it is this one. And this is, in fact, even more coercive than the original one, because you have added on the interface a positive term. Alpha is positive, so everything is good. Now the problem, in fact, the difficulty comes from here. Here, your right-hand side, which depends on what you had in the neighboring subdomain. So the neighboring subdomain so you have to evaluate on this interface this quantity. So you have a normal derivative, but of a quantity which belongs to a domain omega 2. And for domain omega 2, this part of the boundary is nothing, basically. These are interior points. So you have to be able to locate these interior points in your code, let's say, and to take something which is not natural at all when you have a variational formulation, which is a normal derivative. Because if you want to have something consistent with the original finite element discretization, you cannot simply say that you take the gradient times the normal derivative. It will fail. It will not be consistent with the global scheme. You have to be more careful. And being more careful means a lot of work. OK, so the difficulty in the implementation of this method comes from really discretizing correctly the right-hand sign in the Lyon's algorithm. OK, but fortunately, there is a fix, which is called the Horace preconditioner, which was developed by Amix Saint-Cyr and Martin Gander and the co-author. And this is written here. So you define a preconditioner, which is called Horace, for optimized restricted additive Schwarz. This is the same formula than the Horace method, except that instead of taking locally the inverse of the local matrix you extract from your global matrix, you replace that by BI, which is the matrix corresponding to the variational formulation of your Robin boundary value problem. So in a finite element volume or finite element code, this is very easy to have. And so it defines the preconditioner. And you have the following nice thing, is that once again, if you know, we have two algorithms. We have a discretization of the Lyon's algorithm, as I said, which is difficult. And we have, let's say, a fixed point use of the Horace preconditioner, where at each step, you compute a residual. You apply the preconditioner. And since this is a sum, this is a parallel method. And with that, you update your approximate solution globally. And the good thing is that if at step zero, you have equivalence between the discretized Lyon's algorithm and the Horace iterative method, it will be true for all iterations. Which means that un here is what you get with the Horace method, and un and u2n is what you would get with the discretization of the Lyon's algorithm. You make a weighted sum of this local thing. On the interface, you have non-matching quantities, but with this sum, you can get something which is uniquely defined, and the algorithms are the same. And this is a huge simplification in the implementation of the Lyon's algorithm, because now you don't need any discretization of boundary right-hand side. So this is one. And in practice, of course, as before, we never use this kind of simple fixed point method, because this is far too slow compared to what you can get when you use Kryloff method. So what is good with Kryloff method, as was said also yesterday morning by Chris Wick, is that, and by Matthew as well in the afternoon, is that not only it is faster than the fixed point method, but if your fixed point method is basically good except for a few eigenvalues, which would lead to a very slow convergence or even a divergence of the algorithm, the Kryloff method will take care of that very efficiently, almost optimally. And then it is a good way to have convergence. Okay, and the last thing that was not seen at that time, I hope I will try to speak about it, is that it is the first step toward the global theory for the Lyon's algorithm, parallel to the one we have for the additive Schwarz method. Okay, so as I said, the one of the main use, let's say, of this kind of method is for Helmholtz equation. So for Helmholtz equation is written here. So omega is a comes from the frequency. And in fact, you start from the wave equation, which models, for instance, the variation of pressure when you speak, which is here. And you look for solutions which are of this type, which have this periodicity with capital I, which is the square root of minus 1. And if you look to the equation satisfied by utility, if you want, and you insert simply this form in the equation, And then the second order derivative in times becomes the multiplication by I omega squared, which is minus omega squared. This is the way you get the Helmholtz equation. Okay, so this is a symmetric operator, but the bad news is that now you have lost positivity. The minus Laplace gives rise to a positive operator, but now you have a minus omega square, and so you have something negative, and you lose many things. For instance, if you consider a directly boundary value problem, it is not necessarily well posed. For instance, if omega squared is an eigenvalue of the Poisson problem, this problem is ill-posed. Okay. So it means that you are, when you use the classical, if you would use the classical Schwarz method, you would not be safe. Although in practice, it is very rare to have an exact zero from a numerical computer, you can get close to this situation, which means that your solution will behave very badly when omega gets close to real eigenvalue, and you will get into trouble. The other thing is that if you make a simple study, as we've seen before, for global domain R2, which is divided into two half planes, the convergence rate is written here. So what you see depends, of course, on the wave number k, but also on the frequency omega. And when k is large, which means you have, this is still OK, because you have the square root of a positive number, which is something positive, so you have a decay of rho. But if you look at what is called propagative waves, means when the Fourier number in the space is smaller than the frequency in time, then this term is negative, so you have the square root of a negative term, which means that you have a purely imaginary term, and the exponential will be the exponential of some imaginary number. The modulus is one, which means you have no convergence. And you have no damping, so for propagative modes. Okay, so now what was done by Bruno Després is to start from Lyon's algorithm and to to modify it so that it works for the Helmholtz problem. And in this case, the good thing is to take as interface condition this one, where if you want alpha is equal to I omega, so now alpha is a purely imaginary number. And this condition is natural because it corresponds to what is called an impedance condition in acoustics, or to. Okay. And so he was able to extend the proof of Pierre Lulions to this case, which is not easy because you lose positivity of the operators. You have to work a lot in functional analysis to prove convergence when you have non-overlapping sum domains. And it was extended later to Maxwell's system. And also, this method is known as the Fetti-2LM method. Okay, so now if you have overlapping sum domains, which is our case now, and you consider a simple situation where your global domain is a whole space divided into two half planes. So once again, using a Fourier transform in the y direction, k is a dual variable, you can compute explicitly the convergence rate, which will depend on the size of the overlap delta, on k and omega. And you have to make a distinction between propagative waves, which corresponds to k smaller than omega, and vanishing modes or evanescent modes, which correspond to k larger than omega. And you see there is the convergence will come from, will be very different. Because for propagative waves, you have this term in the exponential, this is the exponential of an imaginary number. So the modulus is one. So overlap doesn't help for this, in this case. But now, if you consider propagative modes, you have this thing, but you can suppress the square root of I everywhere, because it is everywhere in this formula. And what you get is simply minus omega 2 minus k squared minus omega divided by the same square root plus omega. And remember that this formula is valid when k is smaller than omega, which means that omega 2 minus q2, k2, is a positive number. So we have a positive number minus omega over the same positive number plus omega, which is smaller than 1 in modulus. And this is the graph convergence for the propagating modes. And now, if you look at the vanishing modes, which are here, now the overlap helps, because you have the exponential of negative number. But now here, you have, in fact, a rational fraction of complex number divided by its conjugate. So the norm in this case is 1. So the modulus here is 1. So convergence comes from the overlap. But overall, for all wave number, except for k equal to omega, which is a frequency cut, you have a convergence rate smaller than 1. And then, once again, what you do is that you don't use a simple fixed point method that I've shown up to now, but you use this method as a preconditioner in Kryloff methods such as GMRS or BiCG stab, which works as well for complex valued problems. Okay, so just to show things you can do with that, and also to speak about also implementation packages, let's say. Okay, so we applied these tools to simulate, in fact, an imaging chamber based on electromagnetic waves, which is used to image brain for people who have strokes. Well, this is a project by an Austrian startup, which is called the EM tensor. And in order to simulate that, this is the volume in which the wave, the Maxwell waves, electromagnetic waves propagate. So the first thing you have to do is to make a mesh of the volume where the Maxwell equations are valid. And then to solve the Maxwell equation in this 3D, on this 3D mesh. And for this, we did that using two in-house but open source libraries, which are HPDDM, which stands for High Performance Domain Decomposition Method, which was developed, which is developed mainly by Pierre Jolivet, who is here. And FreeFM++, maybe some French students or maybe others know it already, which is a finite element package, which is very convenient, and that was parallelized something like, I don't know, let's say 8 years ago, something like that. And now it is interfaced with HPDDM, so that you can run FreeFM++ in parallel. When you download it, you download the sequential on the parallel version, and you download as well HPDDM, and there are examples which are given, and the use of the combination, combined use, if you want, of HPDDM and FreeFM++. Okay, so just to show some pictures, so this is a small, let's say, mesh with 2 million degrees of freedom. Here you have the domain partition before we add some overlaps. So this is an automatic mesh partition, so you see that, well, there is, well, obviously that was done by hand, okay. And here is a typical solution. So it corresponds to one antenna, which emits a signal, and the other antenna, receives the signal. And here is the modulus of the solution, let's say. And the good thing is that using 64 cores on the SGI machine at University of Paris 6, the solving time is only 3 seconds per antenna. Which means that if you want to, in practice, we have to solve 160 problems because each antenna can emit a signal, and the whole process takes 5 minutes. Okay. So this is for overlapping subdomains. Now, when you have non-overlapping subdomains, this is different. So, what I will present is comes from a joint paper with Martin and Frédéric Magoulès. So once again, it is for the Helmholtz equation. But now we have non-overlapping subdomains. What I mean by that is that we have something like this. Okay, so we have really a partition of the domain. So you have a partition of the domain, but you must imagine that if you have a finite element mesh, for instance, in fact, the degrees of freedom on the interface will be duplicated. So you have to be careful with that when you read papers on domain decomposition method. They speak about non-overlapping partition and so on. This is true on the geometric level. But when you look at the degrees of freedom, you have, in fact, duplication of unknowns. OK, so then what we did is to consider more general interface conditions than Robin ones. So the interface condition we consider as a normal derivative plus some parameter alpha, and as well a second order derivative with the parameter gamma. Now the auto corresponds to the tangential derivative along the interface. Okay, so once again, n is a normal outward derivative, and tau is a tangential derivative along the interface. But there are good reasons I have no time to explain to introduce this kind of more sophisticated interface condition. Okay. And now, what you can do, once again, in the simple case when you have a domain decomposed into two subdomains, but not an arbitrary domain, but the whole plane R2, and you divide it into two half planes. Then you have this picture. So omega 2 is here, but you have no overlap now. You have omega 1. OK, so one motivation for having non-overlapping subdomains is mainly the fact that when you have, it enables to have have different grids in each subdomain. Okay. When you have non-matching grids, you have many tools like the Mortar method developed by Yvon Madet, Christine Bernardi, and Tony Patera. I will not speak about them, but this is there is a whole theory which tells you how to glue together two non-matching grids. Okay. But this theory is not developed when you have overlapping subdomains, when the grids overlap. So you have situations where you are like this, and then you have no overlap, and you want to do something. OK, so now the convergence rate is given here, so there is no overlap, so no delta in the formula, it makes sense. And what you see here is that depending on whether you have a propagating wave or vanishing or evanescent modes, you have two different formula. And what you see here is that you are very happy to, you have to consider alpha and gamma to be complex numbers in order to have something which should be smaller than one, both for the propagating and the evanishing modes. OK, then you can work a lot. You can optimize this formula in order to have the smaller convergence rate. So how is the convergence rate defined? This is important for this kind of work. You have a formula which depends the convergence rate, which is given by a formula, which depends on the wave number k, and parameters alpha and gamma. And what you can say is that, in fact, so this is the convergence rate in the Fourier space, which depends on the Fourier number k. And what you can say is that, in practice, what you will see in your code, in fact, is the worst possible case, which means the max over k of all convergence rate for all waves number. OK, and this is what you have to optimize for. What I mean, this is what you want to be as small as possible. So you have a min-max problem. Because now you have three parameters, F-R-I-I, alpha and gamma, and you can choose them in order to have convergence rate as small as possible. And then you can use once you have found this good interface condition, you can use them to build your preconditioner and to use them in a Kreglov method. Okay, so these are old results, but they are still valid, of course. Now, if you compare the original Desprez method, which is a fixed-point method, with Robin interface condition on relaxation parameter equal to 1/2 in order to have convergence, you have this convergence curve. Here, you have the log of the error with respect to the iteration counts. And now, if you use Kreglov method and optimized interface condition, you have a much better convergence curve. This is this one. And basically, what you can say, you have a factor of almost 10 acceleration between these two curves. And 10 is something like 3 by 3. And 3, when 3, let's say, factor comes from the use of Kreglov method instead of purely iterative methods, and the other factor 3 comes from the change in the interface condition. Okay, so once again, we have the difficulty we had before with discretization, that it is difficult to discretize the right-hand side in the interface condition. But now we have non-overlapping subdomains, like it is written here. And for reasons I have no time to explain, we cannot use the trick that works for the coarse method. We have to do something else. So we do something which is classical in mathematics. When you have a problem with something, you give it a name. The square root of minus one is the most famous example of that. And then you go on. So this is what you do. So we give a name to what we do not want to discretize explicitly, and we reformulate the algorithm. So simply, in fact, once you know this right-hand side, you can update in subdomains. So this is easy to discretize this kind of problem. And then what you see is that you can update the right-hand side. OK, maybe I write it because it's not so clear here. OK, so lambda 1 n plus 1. OK, I write it. This is an easy trick, but it's better to write it. So we want to update lambda 1 n plus 1. So by definition, it corresponds to what happens in domain 2 at step n plus 1. OK. So now what you do is that you write this quantity like this. I hope I will not make a mistake. Yes. Okay, so simply what I did is that I subtracted S and I added S, and I already had S before. Okay, so I changed nothing. Okay, and the good thing is that this quantity here is exactly what you have here. This is lambda 2n. And in fact, you use lambda 2n to compute u2n plus 1 by using this interface condition. So you have an update formula where you do not need to discretize any normal derivative. Okay, so it makes implementation, let's say, much easier. And, okay, I don't enter into details, but when you have these tricks, then you can do everything. Ah, zut. Okay, so I didn't put the picture, but we had a very nice picture of of an application of this method. For the acoustic in a car, maybe I can try to locate it because it's a pity not to show it to you. Voilà. Okay, so This is the inside of a car. So here you have the front seat, here you have the back seat, and here somewhere you have the motor. And the motor makes a lot of noise. And car makers want to minimize the noise at the level of the ears of the conductor and the passenger. And for this, they have to solve an Helmholtz equation inside the car. And in order to decrease the level of noise, they can use some special materials to isolate the motor on the top of the roof, on the seat, and so on. So here you have an automatic mesh decomposition into 16 subdomains. And you must imagine that in each subdomain, you have a fine mesh. And you see the interface is very shaky. And nevertheless, we will use our optimization that was made in a simple case. And simply, we adapt the parameters to the local mesh size we have. OK, and here is the result. So this is the level of noise. So when it is blue, it is quiet. And when it is red, there is a lot of noise. So you see that for the passenger, this is perfect. For the driver, it's not too bad. OK, and here you have the iteration counts, where the only thing we change are the interface conditions. So we use the pre-method, let's say, either with ABC0, which corresponds to the pre-interface conditions, absorbing modulation of order 2, okay, which are other kind of impedance conditions, more sophisticated ones, if you want, and the ones we optimized for the bend decomposition method. And all these methods are used as preconditioner for Kryloff method. So they all benefited from Kryloff acceleration. And the cost of one iteration is the same for all methods, because it depends, doesn't depend on the boundary condition. OK, and we increase the number of subdomains from 2 to 16. And you see that we have much better iteration counts using optimized interface condition. OK, and the fact that it is very important to have the good interface condition comes from the fact that we have no overlap in this case. OK, so there have been other works on this kind of idea, so either for Maxwell equations. This is this method is very popular in electrical magnetic simulation, especially in the big group of Gene Falli in the US, which is an electrical engineering department. And this was a big success for a domain decomposition method community, because people in applications consider that this is a method of choice for solving this kind of problem. OK. So. Well, I will have to go faster now, because I have too many slides, as many as the two first speakers yesterday as well. So I will just say a few words, very fast words, on multi-grid methods. So there are many multi-grid solvers, which are free and commercial. NVIDIA has recently made one for their GPU cards. I spoke to the engineer who made the, who wrote the code. It's a nightmare, because in order to have good efficiency on GPU, he had to code using the assembly language of a GPU card. So already programming a GPU card is something very difficult, even if you use a CUDA language. But if you have to resort to assembly language, OK. But then it works well. And okay, also, you have, as it was mentioned yesterday, many good multi-grid solvers. So now, what I want to say a few words, which tell you that, in fact, there is a strong connection between multi-grid method and domain decomposition method. That basically what you can do is, if you consider that, this is a non-standard view to multi-grid method, so let's say you consider that each mesh, you consider that you have a domain decomposition method where each mesh is a subdomain. Then, when you look at the original Schwarz method, it corresponds to inverting simply a problem local to one mesh, which is more or less a diagonal Jacobi preconditioner. Okay. And this diagonal Jacobi preconditioner is one of the building block of a multi-grid method. They call it a smoother. It smooths the residual on the level. And as we have seen from another point of view, and which is well known in multi-grid method, the high frequency mode of the error are quickly dumped by this kind of iterative method. So after a few iterations at the fine level in multi-grid method, you are left with an error which is smooth. And what is done is then to transfer this error to a coarser mesh. And on this coarser mesh, your smooth function becomes a non-smooth function where you can apply a Jacobi method and so on. And you can iterate on that. So basically, a multi-grid method, for instance, in the Wendy case, so at the fine level, you apply your Jacobi method, which is in fact an additive Schwarz method where one subdomain would be simply a cell. And then you transfer the error on a mesh which is twice as large. And then you do it for several times, so several levels, as they say. At some point, you stop. And then you come back to your fine level. Usually, in the domain decomposition method, we consider only two grids. I mean, the additive Schwarz method I presented to you at the beginning corresponds simply to, say, at the fine level, say. And then when we add the second level, it is like adding a coarse grid. But now you already feel there is a big difference in spirit, let's say, in multi-grid and domain decomposition method. In multi-grid, they really go to very cheap, let's say, one-level method, which is simply a diagonal preconditioner, which is very cheap. And in domain decomposition method, we'd rather have big subdomains, where we use direct solver in big subdomains. In fact, we use direct solver as long as they work, as long as they are efficient. And when the domain becomes too large, then they are not efficient, and then we go to an iterative method to ensure the continuity of the solution between the subdomains. In multigrid, this is not the same spirit. The direct solver will be used here at the coarsest level. Okay, but in fact, the correction formula they have, for instance, when they go from... if you consider only a multigrid method with two grids, so first you do some work on the fine grid, then you transfer that to the coarse grid, and then you come back to the fine grid where you work again. And in fact, you can express that as a preconditioner, which has in fact the same form as two-level Schwarz method. You have the one-level method which corresponds to the fine grid, and then you add coarse grid correction which corresponds to this formula if R0 naught corresponds to the restriction from the fine grid to the coarse grid. So there is a lot of things in common in theory, in multi-grid method, not in practice. And you also that this phenomena, when you study the theoretical properties of this kind of method, basically you use the same mathematical tools. Okay, but in multi-grid, they use recursivity. Okay, I will not go into that. But for instance, when they have what is called V-cycle, which means a way to move from one grid to the other, either you can, V-cycle is the simplest thing, you go from your fine grid to a coarser one, to the coarsest one, and then you come back this way, so you get a V. And sometimes what they do are W, so it means that when they are here, they go up, and then they go down once again, and then they go up, and then they get a W. Okay, so there is a language like this, which is the way you move across grids. Okay, and for instance, if you consider a V1 cycle, it also has an expression which uses the same kind of ingredients that was used to define the Mandel balancing domain Neumann method. Okay, I don't want to enter in too many details, I do not have too much time. But so what is good with algebraic multigrid method, as was said by Matthew Kepney yesterday, is that for Poisson or Dassey problems, even with high heterogeneities, it works well. in some sense it is optimal, you can say. This is a black box implementation. I mean, you simply give the matrix to the solver and it will do the work for you. The bad thing that the good thing also is that it's somehow weakly scalable. But the drawbacks is that you have difficulties and even failures when you want to apply it to a complex system like elasticity or Maxwell equations. And then if you want them to work in these cases, they are not so black box, because in order to improve them, you have to provide the solver with the near kernel of the operator. And then you have lost the black box advantage, let's say, of this method. And for wave propagation phenomena, you could say that they fail. Although there are very interesting works by Erlanga, Wick, and Osterling, and how to precondition the wave equation by a shifted Laplacian method for which you can apply the multigrid method. But then you have to work. It's not a direct application of multigrid method. You have to introduce some intermediate step. And also, there is less theory, I would say, for multigrid method than for domain decomposition method, but it's not entirely true. For instance, there are works by Notte in Belgium where they have a lot of very nice theoretical results for domain decomposition, for multigrid method, sorry. Okay. Okay. Now I speak about a little bit once again about direct solver, but not direct solver for themselves, but direct solver as a first step to another kind of iterative method, which are in fact domain decomposition method, but of the sure complement type. I will say only a few words about them. Okay, so as I said, you have very good packages for direct solver, which perform factorization of your matrix as a product of a lower triangular matrix times an upper triangular matrix. Basically, the algorithm is sequential. So it's very difficult to introduce parallelism in a direct solver. And there was a breakthrough with the notion of multifrontal method developed by Jan Duff, essentially, in France and UK. And the idea was to make a partition of the method in this way. So you have, say it corresponds to degrees of freedom. And what you do is introduce two sets of unknowns, U1 and U2, which are separated by a separator, U gamma. And then if you reorder your unknowns using this partition of the unknowns, what you get is the famous arrow form of your matrix with a block form. So U1 not corresponds to degrees of freedom here, U2 in domain 2, and U gamma, the interface, which is called a separator in this kind of thing. And when you have a matrix which has an arrow form, so the arrow now is pointing downwards to the right, then it is good for introducing some parallelism in the factorization that is written here. So in fact, this matrix admits this factorization. And what is good here is that, for the left part, so you have, first of all, three diagonal lower matrix on the left, which involves only the local inverses of A11 and A22, which can be performed in parallel if you want. The same, but the opposite for the triangular upper matrix. And in the middle, you have A11, A22. And the only thing which will need some sequential work corresponds to what happens in the separator, where you have the sure complement S, whose formula is given here. And now, when you use this factorization to solve a problem, in fact, you have so you have to invert each of these three blocks when you apply the inverse of A. Okay, so it is well known that when you have a triangular upper matrix, if you want to invert it, you do not have to invert the coefficient, simply you put a minus in the coefficients. So it means that when you apply this, the inverse of this matrix to some right-hand side, the only thing you have to do is to solve a problem with unknowns in domain 1 or domain 2, which can be done completely in parallel. So you have parallelism. When you invert the diagonal matrix, once again, for degrees of freedom inside domain 1 and 2, this is purely parallel thing. And now for the sure complement, it is also parallel, but you have first to form the sure complement. which is a sequential operation because, and also the main thing is that the complement is a full matrix. So this is the point where you lose compared to pure parallelism, let's say. And then, once again, you have something which is really parallel and concerns only domain 1 and domain 2. Okay, so this is the basis for multifrontal factorization. So what you can do is to have a more sophisticated decomposition. For instance, what you can do it recursively. For instance, you start with the decomposition of the degrees of freedom like this, and then you apply the same idea to the interior unknowns in domain 1. For instance, you introduce a separator, which will be something like this, like a vertical separator in domain 1, so that the degrees of freedom in domain 1 are now separated in free subpieces, let's say, with a separator. And you can do it the same for domain 2, and so on. So you have a recursive approach. And up to, let's say, 10 or 20 cores, it works well. So it gives some acceleration, some parallel acceleration to direct solver, although basically these methods are not are sequential, are not parallel. OK. But the bottleneck, especially when you are in 3D, is the sure complement. OK, so. So once again, about this kind of parallel direct solver, so I repeat it. So if it makes the job, I mean, if the time to get the solution and the memory use is not too big, this is the method of choice because they are robust. They are really black box and robust method. And you can predict in advance the cost. So they are very good methods. But up to a certain size of problems or a number of cores, these methods are not efficient, and you have to resort to iterative methods. OK, so now one idea which was developed in domain decomposition method community was to go from this direct method to preconditioners. So the bottleneck in this direct method is, in fact, to invert the sure complement. And so the idea is to say that, well, OK, when I look at the sure complement equation, what I can do, instead of applying once again a direct solver to it, is now to solve this equation by an iterative method. And I have no time to explain why, but as a matter of fact, this global sure complement, in fact, you can cut it into two pieces, one which comes from domain omega 1, which comes from domain omega 2. So if I come back to the formula which gives you the sure complement. Obviously, this part comes only from domain omega 2 and from the separator, so it is clear. This one comes only from domain 1. And this one, in fact, A gamma gamma, you can split it into two parts. For instance, if you have a finite element code, it is natural when you look at the coefficients of the matrix on the interface points that you have to integrate some variational formula. You can cut the variational formula into two pieces, one which comes from omega 1, one which comes from omega 2, and you have a natural cut of I gamma gamma, and which is what is written here. So A I gamma gamma stands for the contribution of domain I to A gamma gamma. And then what you do is that you approximate the inverse of S, which you build a preconditioner, which has this form. So one half, the local inverses of the local sure complements, which can be performed in parallel in each subdomain, and once again, one half. And why one half here and one half here? It is because if S1 is equal to S2, it is very easy to see that this preconditioner is exact. And the second thing is that now this preconditioner is also parallel. Anyway, it is parallel. Because once again, it is a sum over subdomains, so you can apply it in a parallel setting. And you only have to move data on the interfaces. OK, so this criteria was later on refined and improved, let's say. And this drives to balancing domain-domain decomposition, BDDC, in fact, or FETI, finite element theory and interaction method. And once you add a core space to this basic method, let's say, they work well. So these methods are very popular in the mechanical engineering, since it was the first efficient iterative solver for elasticity problems. Because for Poisson problems, usually the diagonal is dominant, especially if you have a finite difference scheme, which used to be the case for a long time in the applications. So then you can simply use a diagonal preconditioner. It's not very efficient, but it does some work and it improves convergence. When you have elasticity, you lose this kind of behavior. And before this kind of method, there was no efficient iterative solver for elasticity problems. So this is one. The drawback is that you need elementary matrices even for the one-level method. I mean, you know, simply to define the method, you need to have access to the local contribution of each subdomain to the interface matrix. So they cannot be black box routines. And when the decomposition is bad, they are not, they lack robustness. OK. So now I move fast because I want to show you a few things, but there is a lecture notes in the book, more in details. So now I come back to two-level methods, to coarse space. And now we come back to the place where we were before the break, that we have good methods for the Poisson type of problem, or with more or less constant coefficient problems. The thing is that this kind of coarse space that was built by Nicolaides for the first time fails for highly heterogeneous problems. And in fact, in this case, it was known by works by Vrick and co-authors with people in Shell that you need a larger coarse space which depends on the number of heterogeneities you have in your subdomains. But there was no way to build the good coarse space automatically. So first of all, I say that the classical coarse space, which means that which is based on the fact that the constant function 1 is in the kernel of the operator, fails for highly heterogeneous problem. So here we have a Darcy problem, div of alpha grad, and alpha can be a very discontinuous function. So here this is a kind of layers, let's say, with either value of 1, I don't know in which part, in the yellow part, and in the red part, you have a coefficient which is either 10, 10.2, 10 to the power 3, or 10 to the power 4. So you have big jumps in the coefficient. Okay. So if you use the Aditi-Schwarz method with one level, you have a dependence not only on the number of subdomains, but as well on the jump in the coefficients. Here, we vary only the jump in the coefficients. So now, when I speak of robustness, it is with respect to the parameters in your problem. And the last line corresponds to adding a Nicolaides coarse space, which corresponds to constant function in the subdomains, if you want. And you see that it also has a dependency with respect to the jump in the coefficients, which is bad. You do not want to have that. And our approach to fix this problem was to, in fact, enlarge the coarse space Z by an optimal unproven choice. So optimal, this is a practically optimal thing, but the efficiency is proven from A to Z, I would say, from a mathematical point of view. So the strategy we use was the following. We keep the same algebra, if you want. I mean, we improve the basic one-level Aditi-Schwarz method. So I come back to Schwarz method. And we add to it a coarse space. So we define some coarse space by defining some rectangular matrix Z. And we use the same correction formula. So the only thing we will change is the coarse space itself. And we want to have something which is natural, good for parallelism. We want to have things that are as local as possible, which are adaptive with respect to the heterogeneities on the problem that you do not really know, which can be much more complex than this one. Easy and cheap to compute, and robust. What I mean by robust, that must lead to an algorithm whose convergence is proven and does not depend on the partition nor the jumps in the coefficients. Okay, so I skip many things. And the way to do it is the following. So in order to build the coarse space, in each subdomain, you introduce a generalized eigenvalue problem, which is written here. So, okay, so the eigenvalue is mu, jk, so j is the index of the subdomain, and k is the index of the eigenvalue. Vgk is the eigenvector, and you have two matrices. So on the left, you have the Dirichlet matrix, which is RGI, RG transpose, which is left and right multiplied by the partition of unity. And on the right, you have the Neumann matrix of the local subdomain J. Okay, and you look at this generalized eigenvalue problem. It's equal generalized because we have matrix both on the left and on the right. And the user, let's say, chooses a parameter tau. And all eigenvalues which are larger than tau are put in the coarse space using a formula, let's say, which is reminiscent of what Nicolaides had proposed. What I mean is that in each subdomain, we look at the corresponding eigenvectors, we multiply them by the partition of unity, and we extend by zero. And the good thing in this construction is that it automatically includes the Nicolaides coarse space. Why? Because if you have a floating subdomain, what is called a floating subdomain is a subdomain which does not touch the global boundary of the domain. Then the function 1 is in the kernel of the local Neumann matrix, which means that here it gives rise to, let's say, an infinite eigenvalue, if you admit infinite eigenvalue. So automatically, it will be selected in the construction. And if there are heterogeneities, then it will put more than 1 degree of freedom per subdomain. OK, so this was developed in the PhD of Nicole Spillane, who is here. And this was a joint co-direction with Patrice Auret from Michelin Tire Company. And there are also co-authors, Victorita de Leon. I don't remember his first name, Pechstein, and Robert Scheichel. Clemens Pechstein, OK, thank you. OK, and the result is the following. So what we prove is that the condition number of the new two-level additive Schwarz method is bounded by constants that you know explicitly and which do not depend on the number of subdomains. So K-naught is the number of neighbors of one subdomain. So typically, even if you add more and more subdomains, this is more or less a fixed number. And anyway, you know it explicitly. And tau is a parameter which is chosen by the user. So there is no hidden constant in this estimate. The only thing you are left with this, and it is, does not depend on the number of subdomains, does not depend on the jobs in the operator, in the coefficients. It depends only on the parameter tau that you are free to choose. So the last thing to do is to choose the parameter tau. So what we did is to take this formula for tau. So tau is the diameter of one subdomain over the width of the overlap. So we did that because if you take this definition of tau, here you have 1 plus capital H over delta, and then the convergence rate which is here is exactly what you would have for the Poisson problem on two subdomains, typically. And which is the convergence rate that people are happy with. Okay, so we made some numerical experiments. So on the top left figure, you have the permittivity map. So you must imagine that you have, let's say, valor 1 in the yellow, the yellow part, and you have small squares with very high coefficients, which are not the same depending on the color, and you have channels which may or not link these islands. The islands are the small squares here. Okay, this is a typical test case for Darcy problem, and here is a typical solution you get this kind of thing. And we consider two kinds of partitions, either a regular partition of the square into subsquares, you do it by hand, or an automatic mesh partition, and here you have a superposition of the permittivity field and the partition. So here for regular partition, here for an automatic mesh partitioner. And you see that you have no relation between the partition and the coefficients. And the coefficient may vary from a valor equal to 1 to 10 to the power 6. And here are convergence curves. So, Okay, so in blue, you have the log of the error as a function of the iteration counts for the one-level additive Schwarz method. Okay, so it converges, but you have a big plateau at the beginning. It takes some time before it decreases. And in red, you have the two-level method, but with the classical Nicolaides core space, which works very well for constant coefficient problem, but fails when you have high heterogeneities. And in green, we have the method we have called Geneo, with two variants of it, so you have two curves which are almost the same, and you see that you have no plateau. Okay, and in practice, we notice some optimality of the method. What I mean by optimality is the following. So, to what I show, it was in this table, the middle line corresponds to the result you've shown before. This is the iteration counts for the three different methods we consider. So one-level method, two-level Nicolaides, and two-level with the new core space. And now what we do is the following. In the Geneo method, we add one extra mod in each subdomain, one extra eigenvalue. And you look at the iteration counts, they decrease a little bit, but not a lot. And what we do on the other side is that we subtract one mod in each subdomain for our core space, but we keep anyway at least one mod, which is a constant mod. And you see a big jump in the iteration counts. So somehow we have a practical optimality of this case. Yes, Chris? Yeah, yes, well, these are small test cases, so it doesn't make me, it's R2D case, and so on, but I will skip now, okay. So now for large test cases, I come to them. Okay, so what we've done is to use FreeFM++ to all the finite element part, and which is a domain-specific language. So for those who do not know how it works, there will be a talk by Frédéric Hecht this week, which will tell you a lot of things because FreeFM++ is mainly written by Frédéric Hecht. But just to give you an idea, let's say, for instance, if you want to define a Poisson problem, what you do is that you write your variational formulation, you type, in fact, your variational formulation in the code. So it works in 2D or in 3D, so you integrate over your mesh, grad U, grad V. It's exactly what is written here. And the right-hand side is given here in a variational formulation, integral of FV. And when you have directly boundary condition, you say on part of the boundary of the mesh, you impose U equal to zero. And this is enough. But before that, you had defined the mesh. And this is enough to get a solution. And then you again one line, and you say compute the solution, and then you can plot it. So in, let's say, 10 lines, you have solved the problem. So all the hard part, which is to generate the mesh correctly, to build the stiffness matrix, to build the right-hand side, to solve the problem and so on, everything is done for you. You don't have to care about it. So this is what is called domain-specific language. It means that there are, if you want, objects like variational formulation, mesh, and things like that, which are already available to the programmer. This is close, the syntax is very close to C++, but this is not a C++ library. So be careful. You cannot say, I have my C++ code. I will sometime use FreeFM++ by making a call to FreeFM++. It will not work. You have to go by file. You have to store something on a file and read it in FreeFM++, and then export your result if you want to use FreeFM++ with a C++ code. Or what you can do is to stay with FreeFM++ from the start to the end. Okay. So for large test case, okay. So for instance, this is a strong scalability test case for a three-dimension heterogeneous elasticity problem. So not a Darcy problem, elasticity problem in this case. And so we consider 160 million degrees of freedom. Starting from 1,000 cores to, let's say, 6,000 cores. And here you would have a perfect speed up. And here is the speed up we get in blue. So it's already good. And for instance, I don't know if it's written somewhere. You have the number. Ah, it's not the iteration. Okay. And now we have a weak scalability test case, for instance, in 3D for Darcy, a problem with 2 billion unknowns with very heterogeneous coefficients, like the ones I've shown you. And then we can go up to 2 billion unknowns or 8,000 cores in 200 seconds. Okay, so, well, many things to say. Now, just to say for people who like, they say, Hilbert spaces and mathematical analysis and so on, I didn't speak about general proofs. So I said we have theorems and so on, but I didn't say how we get them. So I will have time to explain everything, but there is a key thing, which is to reformulate this method in an even more abstract way by introducing some Hilbert spaces. So just to give you an idea for how it works, so at the beginning, you have a general equation. AU is equal to F, let's say. And the first thing you do is that you consider that you have a bilinear form associated to that, if A is symmetric, positive, definite. And you have, so, an Hilbert space H, which is simply R to the power the numbers of degrees of freedom. And, okay. And then, what you have is that you have a domain decomposition, and in each subdomain, you have a subset of degrees of freedom, which are labeled by, which correspond to the subset Ni. So this has the degrees of freedom you have in subdomain I. And you consider Hilbert space, which is a product of the local degrees of freedom. So which is a product over the number of subdomains, capital N, of R to the power the number of degrees of freedom in domain I. And you can undo this, let's say, product space with a bilinear form, which is written here, which corresponds, in fact, to the local Dirichlet matrix, Ri, R, Ri transpose. OK? So why not? And then attached, let's say, to this bilinear form, you have a representation of it, like by a linear operator, that is usual with when you have Hilbert spaces. And the fact is that with all these things, in fact, the additive Schwarz preconditioner has this compact formula, where, okay, I forgot something. So you have also an operator which will link both spaces. So this operator takes you from the product space to the target space, I would say, or the decomposed space to the target space. And what it does is that it takes local components, it extends them by zero, and it makes a sum over all subdomains. Okay, so this is a way to establish a link between H and HD. So in fact, when you look at it carefully, the one-level Schwarz method had this compact formula, where R star is the transpose, if you want, of operator R. Okay, so I do not enter into detail, but the good thing is that why did we do that? It is because, in fact, this abstraction of the methods was made by Neponiatchik in 1991. And he has found a very powerful lemma, which is called the fictitious space lemma, which is the following. So it tells you that, well, you have two Hilbert spaces. On this of these Hilbert spaces, you also have one extra symmetric positive definite form. And you have an operator from the decomposed space, HD, to the target space, H. And you have three assumptions to check. The fact that R is surjective. The fact that somehow R is continuous if you undo H with with a norm associated to A and HD with a norm associated to B. So CR is kind of a continuity constant of R. And you have what is stable decomposition estimate. This is the third one. In fact, if capital R were invertible, it would be, in fact, to write the fact that R minus 1 is also continuous with a constant 1 over CT. OK, since it is not invertible, you have a more elaborate formula, definition. And what you get in the end is that he proves that, in fact, the eigenvalues of R, B minus 1, R star, R star is the adjoint operator for R, applied times A, belongs to the interval CTCR. And in fact, since we have seen before that this thing is exactly the additive-Schwarz method, in fact, it gives you a general way to evaluate the smallest and largest eigenvalue of the precondition system of an additive-Schwarz method, for instance. And this lemma is a kind of lax Milgram lemma of domain decomposition methods. What I mean is that all domain decomposition methods that I know of, so the ones I've shown you, so additive-Schwarz method, also ORAS, so optimized restricted additive-Schwarz, but also sure complement methods, what we've seen like FETI method or BDD method, you can write all of them with this abstract setting. And in fact, what you have to do is to check these three things, and once you have them, you are done. Okay, so I do not enter into detail, but this is the way it is done. So I skip many things because I don't have time to go into details. So, so for instance, the good thing, for instance, using this kind of thing, so what I mean this kind of thing is using a combination of optimized restricted additive-Schwarz and automatic coarse space construction, which is called Geneo2, we are able also to solve Stokes' problem. For instance, in 3D, with a good coarse space. And well, this is a strong scalability test. We have 50 million degrees of freedom in 3D. And the smallest time is 57 seconds on a machine which is slow, which is an IBM Blue G machine. It is slow because for two reasons. The first one is that the processor works only at 1.6 gigahertz, whereas you on the Intel type machine, you have 3 gigahertz, basically. So you lose a factor of two. And the second thing is that for strange reasons, the network is not very efficient. And it impacts you of a factor of two as well. So basically, if you had run these test cases on a Curie machine, for instance, you could divide the times by four. And also, what we've done is to consider almost incompressible elasticity problem with a sandwich made of rubber and steel. And we made some weak scalability tests. So this is very difficult because rubber is almost incompressible, but it's very soft. Okay, so it means it is very difficult to compress it, but it is very easy to stress it in this direction, to strain. And steel is something different. Well, compared to rubber, it is easy to compress. Well, you have to be strong, but it's much easier than almost incompressible thing. But on the other hand, it is very solid when you want to make shear displacement. So this is a very heterogeneous problem. And what we see is that in 3D, so it corresponds to the blue curves, we are able to solve in 200 seconds a problem with 200 million unknowns on 8,000 cores. Okay, so very quickly, I will speak about the HPDDM libraries. For unfortunate, I do not have time enough. So what is important is that all these results were obtained by a combination of FreeFM++ and HPDDM. And the good thing is that when you download FreeFM++, you download HPDDM as well. And the source code which enables us to make this test is the one you download. So if you have access to a big machine and you are able to compile FreeFM++ on it, you ask Frédéric how to do it, then you will be able to run this test. Okay, and the other thing is that you can also have it worked on your small cluster or even on your PC if you have a parallel PC. So, okay, what is important is that HPDDM is also used by Phil++, which is another free finite element package. But then it is really, Phil++ is really C++ finite element library, which means you can use it inside your C++ code, which looks good, but the drawback is that it is very long, the compiling time are very long. because everything is based on a template. And every time you modify something, everything is recompiled. So, well, you have to choose. And also, HPDDM can be used as a standalone thing. So there are examples which come with the distribution of HPDDM, which shows you how to use it. For instance, if you have a finite difference code and you want to have domain decomposition method, it is written how to use that. And so in HPDDM, what is implemented is a Schwarz type method, Horace tap type method, and also Shure complement type method like BDD or FETI. And also, there are block methods. What I mean is that you have several right-hand side, and you want to solve them at once. So you have many things to go faster than simply the solve, one solve times the number of right-hand side. And also recycling, which is a good way when you have solved the first system with some right-hand side, and you have to solve either the same system or a closely related system with another right-hand side, you can recycle what you've learned from the first solve to the other solve. And what is implemented is a method by Eric de Sturler, JCRODR, which is very efficient. And also, there is an example where you start only from scratch from a metric stored in a file. And soon there will be an interface with PETSI preconditioners in order to be able to use the block Kryloff method. Okay, so I skip that. I skip unsymmetric operators, so pity, because it was work we did with Caroline. Just to say that, this is important, when you have a non-symmetric problem, for instance, convection diffusion equation, which is written here, so the non-symmetric part comes from this term here, you can use Lyon's algorithm, but you have to be careful. You have to be careful in the sense that the interface condition you use at outflow is not the same as the one you use at inflow. And this is very important if you want to have good methods. So this is written here. So the good choice is to take the normal derivative plus, in fact, the normal component of the flow, which will change if you have an interface. If this is domain omega 1, domain omega 2, let's say your velocity is like this. So you see that at this, for domain omega 1, A dot scalar N1 is positive. And for domain omega 2, this is the opposite. And so which means that in the interface between two subdomains, you do not have the same interface condition. At least there is one difference, there are other differences, but you have to be careful with that. And then, once again, you can optimize your interface condition with respect to the parameter alpha, beta, and gamma. And when there is no overlap, it is a big gain to make a good optimization. And this was done in the PhD thesis of Caroline, and other people also worked on this kind of ideas. I skip that. This is, okay, I skip. Okay, so just to say a few, I have shown things that work. Many things work well, but of course there are still many things which have to be investigated. I mentioned a few ones. So in the what I've shown about coarse space, the coarse space is built before we solve, and then we use it to solve. So we mean we have a setup time, which is large, and then a very fast iteration part, solving part, if you want. And maybe it could be good if you could build the coarse space on the fly between during the first solves with the one-level method. So Nicole Spillane is working on this, and we had made some work with a PhD student, Nicole Zidlersky, on this kind of idea. Also, when you solve many different times closely related problems, you would like to reuse the coarse space from one solve to the other to save the setup time, but if your metrics has changed too much, maybe it's not a good idea, so how to be able in advance to say what is good or what is not good. So this is also a direction of research. To go to more than two levels for domain decomposition method, the multigree-like fashion. And also, which is still a big issue, how to build efficiently and automatically efficient coarse space for non-symmetric or indefinite problems like convection diffusion equation for non-symmetric or Helmholtz or Maxwell equation for indefinite problems. Okay, I thank you for your attention and your references.
Thank you. Do you have any question, Martin?
Why was this particular eigenvalue problem chosen from Genio? Was it to make the fictitious space lemma work, or was there other insight?
Well, there are two insights.
What was the key insight?
Okay, so there are two ideas, let's say, in it. No, it's not here. So you have to have the fictitious space lemma work. This is for sure. I don't know where it was. Sorry, I'm sorry for people who had headache with that, but I know I put it somewhere.
I saw it.
I skipped it, but you, thank you to have asked a question. Ah, okay. So you have two motivations. The motivation is when you start from the proof of the condition number estimate for the one-level method, you see there are, and you apply it, you studied it, let's say, with a fictitious space lemma, you see at some point some constants are not good. And you say, oh, I want to improve these constants, and you are led naturally to the generalized eigenvalue problem. This is one way to see it. Another way, which is heuristic, but which works very well in many situations, is the following one. This was not prévu à l'avance. Hein, it was, okay, so in fact, you have two preconditioners. You have the one I've shown you, which is the Aditi-Schwarz method, where you have a good bound for the largest eigenvalue, but a very bad one for the smallest eigenvalue. Now, okay. Now another one that I've not shown you yet is the Neumann, I call it a Neumann-Neumann preconditioner, which is written like this. So instead of inverting a local matrix, directly matrix, you invert a local Neumann matrix. Let's say it is invertible. You forget about the, or use the pseudo-inverse, it is not invertible. Okay, and you use on the left and the right partition of unity. And you study this algorithm with the preconditioner with the fictitious space lemma, it is very easy to prove that you have a bound for the smallest eigenvalue. It is bounded from below by 1 over k1. k1 is the maximum multiplicity of subdomains. I don't worry too detail. Very closely related to the number of neighbors, let's say, to make it simple. So let's say you have a good bound on the lower eigenvalue, but the largest eigenvalue are very bad. So now you have two simple algorithms, which are one-level method. One has a very good bound for the lowest eigenvalue, the other one for the largest eigenvalue. So what you will say, OK, I will combine them to have a perfect preconditioner. In fact, you cannot, because in fact, the bad modes, if you want, are the same for both algorithms. So you cannot mix them to have a good algorithm. But what you can say is that it gives you a way to identify the bad modes. Because you would say that if these two algorithms are the same, were the same at some point, it would be a very good algorithm. But they are, both of them are given by a sum. Here it is a sum like this. And for the Schwarz method, this is a sum of RI transpose AI RI. So what you would say is that, this is heuristic, the bad modes correspond to vectors for which these two matrices that appear in the preconditioners act differently. And since this is a sum, you can evaluate that locally in each subdomain. And now you have inverses and so on, so you can manipulate all this, so you put DI on the... you do some simple algebra. And in fact, it corresponds to looking at when you have this kind of eigenvalue problem and the eigenvalue is far from one. I mean, the action of some vector and some modes of these two matrices are very different. And then it is exactly the Genio generalized eigenvalue problem.
Thank you, Dallas.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes.
Can you comment on the cost of the local generalized eigenvalue problem? And also, how sensitive is Genio with respect to the accuracy of the computed eigenvalues?
OK, so where is it? OK, so when we set up the algorithm, we have to solve in each subdomain this generalized eigenvalue problem. So the first thing which is good is a purely parallel task. No communication at all is involved. Okay, so if you have if your subdomain is too big, it's not too expensive. The second thing that in practice, what we noticed is that basically, when you set up a domain decomposition method, you also have to factorize your local submetrics, which is already in 3D something. And in fact, you can use this factorization when you solve this generalized eigenvalue problem. And then the extra cost coming from Genio is to double the setup time, so, which is something, but it's not that expensive. And now for the accuracy, well, typically, it is, well, in practice, it is robust. We have no theory for that. But for instance, at the beginning, we were very cautious. So we would take something like a tolerance equal to 10 to the power minus 8 or 6 in the generalized eigenvalue problem. And with 10 to the power minus 4, basically, it still works well. Because what is important here is that what we want to have is it's not really each separated eigenvalue. What is important for us is a core space spanned by the eigenvalues. And usually, this kind of iterative solvers for generalized eigenvalue problem are iterative methods which have difficulties to separate too close eigenvalues. But we don't care. Simply, what we want to have is a core space spanned by the two eigenvalues. So in practice, it works, but we have no theory for that.
Any question? I have one. Genio, you have the parameter tau, mm-hmm. and you show us a formula with the overlap. Mm-hmm. But the formula is because the overlap is linked to the mesh size, right? Or not?
No, it's just simply because.
Is delta H or 2H or
yeah, okay.
small H?
Okay.
Or,
so in practice,
is it important or not in the choice of tau?
Well, in practice, delta, in what we do, which is called small overlaps, I mean, the overlap is one mesh size or two mesh size, 1H, 2H, something like that. And, but if we had a larger overlap, you would use the same formula. Okay, simply we use this formula because this is a formula which appears in the original theory of Nicolaides for his core space for a pure Poisson problem with constant coefficient. And usually people when they solve Poisson problem with domain decomposition method using Nicolaides core space, they're happy with what they get. So in order to have the same kind of happiness, I would say, we take the same criteria. But you're free to choose what you want.
Okay, thank you. I have just one comment because Frédéric didn't have time to say all of this about optimized transmission conditions. They serve also as a preconditioner because they are depending on the mesh size and the time step. And this means that the convergence is less affected when you refine the mesh, the grid and in space and the time grid, than if you use classical transmission condition, Dirichlet or Neumann. So I think it's important also to say that.
Okay.
So thank you, Frédéric, for your nice talk.